We are very fortunate that Jennifer Wilson is moderating the next panel. She is one of the directors of the Project Factory. Many of you here know the Project Factory. They're a specialist in cross-platform, multi-strategy and development with a special interest in creative content and solutions. They work with heritage media makers to translate their narratives and brand messages into interactive and digital messages, online, on mobile and social media, in virtual worlds and through gameplay. Jennifer's previous roles include Head of Innovation for Nine MSN, and she sits on the executive of AMIA. Please welcome digital guru, Jennifer Wilson.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that, Megan. And thanks for all of you for coming here. It's always good to come to the Vivid Sessions. I think the one thing I really love about these is the audience engagement and how people seem to... I mean, I like the proximity of the stage to the audience, but I also like the engagement we get from the audience ourselves. So I'm really hoping that we're going to have quite interesting interactions during both of these panels. The first one, as you know, is the panel for more of the professional producers. And the second one, I think, is people who've been creating their own identity and are highly professional at what they're doing. So I don't mean to show any level of disregard for that at all. Joining me here is, first of all, Tony Broderick, who is responsible for the development and production of digital extensions and social media for TV brands of X Factor, Australia's Got Talent and Neighbours. He's from Fremantle Media. He's an industry expert in using social media and has significantly grown the audience. In fact, in 12 months on the X Factor, he achieved a 600% increase in views on YouTube. Next to him is Steve Crombie. Steve is a leading digital content strategist and storyteller who works in development, production, and presenting for television, online magazines, and NGOs. From evaluating digital video opportunities for Lonely Planet's global CEO to leading all things digital at Australia's biggest independent production house, Cordell, Jigsaw, Zapruder, which of course leads to Nick Murray. Executive producer, founder of Cordell Jigsaw, and CEO of Cordell Jigsaw, Zapruder, Australia's largest independently owned production company. As EP, Nick's projects included the international Rose Door winning Go Back to Where You Come From, the popular factual series Bondi Rescue, and the spectacular aerial documentary series Great Southern Land. Thank you very much for joining me. Steve, I'd like to start with you. Can you give me a little bit of a view of YouTube? We've heard from Kristen about the importance of it and how it is, and there was a lot of information to take in that session. When you start working with people like Nick and with CJZ, what are the key things about YouTube that you need to explain to them to get them aware of what the potential of this is?
I guess one, well, there's many ways you can go about it. Obviously, it's a whole different platform you can, you know, use to create and share your content. At the moment, if you're a producer for TV, you've got a very typical cycle from, you know, creating your content, developing your content, getting it up on air. Does it rate? Doesn't it rate? If it doesn't rate, often people end the cycle there. But with something like YouTube, it gives you a lot more opportunities to engage with your content, to find your community, and to... you know, continue on with that program. I mean, it's a great place to, you know, test your idea in the market. Does it work? Doesn't it work? You know, can you find a community? Can you build a community around your content? When you go to pitch that program again to a network, if you already have a community for that content, then it's much easier to get a program up. You've already tested it. You can use the analytics to identify where your program may or may not work, in what context, in what demographic. That obviously facilitates the development of your program and helps you improve your processes. And as well, if you're going back to a network, it also ensures that you have more ownership over your digital rights as well, because you've already built that community. So you're going there with ownership of that content, so they can't, it's harder for them to tear that away from you, I guess. And then you can obviously continue the cycle, you know, moving through there. There's a lot of other different areas, but I mean that's a really sort of pretty important section to go through.
Kristen, explain about content IDs. How important are they for content owners?
Content ID is extraordinary, particularly with, you know, for example, with Nick's assets. It's really only once you get the content up there that you can identify what's available. There's one way you can sort of, I guess, smash and grab and say, this is mine, this is mine, this is mine. But once you actually upload the content and it automates the process for you, you'd be surprised at how much revenue you can generate with your assets. A lot of you probably already have assets online that you're not monetizing proficiently, but once you do get your content up there, you'll be monetizing instantaneously. So the more time you leave to get your content, you're simply, I guess, losing dollars, and the sooner you get your content up there, the sooner you're able to monetize.
So in some ways, you're saying that the fan-picked content, where people are loading the content, they're actually doing the work for you by getting your content onto YouTube, and then you can go in and slap your little moniker on it and claim the revenue.
Yeah, they are doing the work for you. You do earn the same amount. The difference is you don't have control over the interface, so you can't change the annotations or, you know, the titling and all that sort of thing. But you still monetize it exactly the same way. You can still get access to all of the analytics, and still, you know, it helps you understand your market. You might find from your fan base content that a lot of people from Norway are uploading your content, and you're like, oh wow, you know, we've got an audience in Norway. Why don't we go and sell it to a broadcaster? They're our program. It might help with formatting. It helps with a lot of different areas.
Okay. Nick, how did Cordell Jigsaw start moving into this space, and what were you doing before Steve and after Steve, and what's happened for you in the last year or a couple of years?
In the last three years, I mean, it's not all rosy. I should point that out. You know, I saw a presentation a couple of years ago at the Edinburgh TV Festival about YouTube and the analytics that I don't know, it was PricewaterhouseCoopers or someone like that had done some analysis on what was happening on YouTube. They said that more than 90% of the content on YouTube, I mean, the figure about how much is uploaded every minute, for me, is meaningless, because what they said was more than 90% of the content on YouTube is watched by less than 10 people. And quite a lot of that, I think they said, you know, something like 20% of that had been watched by no people at all, including the person who put it up. So there's a lot of stuff up there that's rubbish, and I mean, we know that. I mean, it's amazing that 98 million people have watched that ridiculous cat thing. It's not even a cat playing the piano. I can't believe it. But from our point of view, what we did, I mean, if you understand that, and we work with Jennifer on some digital stuff for the App Store as well, for the Apple App Store, what you've got to realise is when you do that stuff, it is going up, in the App Store's case, it's going up in a universe where there are 400,000 other apps up there and you're trying to have something that cuts through. In the case of YouTube, it's you know, almost an infinite amount of material that's up there. So everything that we've been doing in the last 3 years has been trying to work out ways, and some of it's been experimental, work out ways where we can generate revenue from, direct revenue from the digital work that we're doing. And we look at the work that Shine and Fremantle are doing. It's amazing, and it's a real credit to them. They're coming off the back of very, very, you know, strong brands, and they've worked out how to leverage that. What we've been trying to do is work out how to leverage brands that aren't necessarily international brands. They might have a strong audience here, or we might have a stronger audience online than we do with the show itself. So in the case of the Ronnie Johns Half Hour, which is a sketch comedy series we did for Channel 10, sort of in 2007, 2006, 2007 or something, that show is very, very strong still on YouTube. It's got it's one of the strongest performing Australian comedy on YouTube at all, out of all the Australian comedy on YouTube. I think the show's views are sort of 20 to 30 million for the clips that we've got up there, and there aren't that many, and they're not that great quality, but 20 to 30 million views on YouTube for that show. Some of the clips, there's a chopper weather clip that's, you know, millions just by itself. And then we've got shows like Hungry Beast, which there's a clip from Hungry Beast, one clip from Hungry Beast, which has got 27 million views. So that's a show that was made for ABC a couple of years ago, finished. And so what we've been trying to do is work out how to get that stuff, which has a very strong audience, a stronger audience than it had on air. In the case of the Hungry Beast clip, more people have seen that than live in Australia. So it clearly isn't just an Australian audience watching it. So there's stuff happening outside Australia, and we've also been grappling with the networks sometimes claiming ownership of our content outside Australia. And we've been battling with them to try and get it, because when we go to claim it, turns out the networks claim the same content, you know, for the rest of the world, and they don't have that right. So we've been battling that. The key thing we've been trying to do is to break even. So we've been working for the last 3 years. We've probably spent, I don't know, a couple hundred thousand dollars, which has all been down, on a pure bottom line terms, it's been down the drain, because we haven't been making money. We've been spending more money than we've been making. But that has been a long-term plan to try and get our views up to a number of views a month. And I don't quite understand all this stuff, but you have to get up to a certain number of views in order to exponentially increase your ad revenue and some other revenue. And we're at the stage now where we've just started breaking even on the expenditure we're making. So that's a great result. And I think since we joined up as a YouTube partner, we've had about 100 million views of our content since the YouTube partnership started. So that's really significant, and you know, when a show might rate between, you know, 800,000 and, you know, 1.5 million in Australia, that's fantastic. And we've got a cable show too, Mega Truckers, which is very strong online as well. So it's an interesting world. It's something that we're still grappling to understand, and we're working with Steve to try and get a better understanding of that. I'm a real curmudgeon about this stuff because I want to see it direct. You know, I'm used to pitching a show to a TV network. They like it. They offer to pay for it. We make it, and hopefully there's a profit that comes out of that. This is a much more different, it's a very different prospect because it's an investment in building some of those channels that we just saw and working out how to, you know, run the metadata properly and all the rest of the things that will lead to more views, you know.
Can I ask, when you start thinking about channels, do you think about CJZ as a channel or Hungry Beast as a channel? Or, you know, is a show, a series, a channel? Or how do you make the distinction between what will be the channel for you?
I think we're doing both. And the show, there's a Bondi Rescue channel which we've been playing with. And Bondi Rescue is a great example. That has a fantastic online community through Facebook. The lifeguards themselves have, I don't know, they've got about, you know, 100,000 in their world. We've got another 100,000 odd in the show itself's world, which is run by a fan. The network started running that Facebook page, and it had 76, you know, friends or whatever they were, and now it's got 100,000 because we let a fan run it, and it's been a great result, that one. So that, and then we have a lot of engagement with people all around the world with that show. So that's its own channel. And the other thing we've been able to do with Bondi Rescue is we've used the analytics from the views of the clips that are online to help put together. We did two best of specials over Easter this year. They were that was sort of the content for that was being driven by the analytics of the clips that were online on YouTube and seeing who liked it and what they liked, and that helped in creating what people call heritage media. I call it paying media. but that helped create, you know, a show that we were paid to make.
And just a last one, there's a couple of things we'll come back to later. Roughly what percentage of the content from CJZ that's available on YouTube do you think you uploaded versus what was, I'll say, fan-picked? Do you have any sense of how much was from you and how much was from the fans?
Well, in some cases we're not allowed to upload the content, so there are, you know, there's some content which was entirely uploaded by fans, but I don't know in fact it's hard to work it out as a percentage as far as what's there. It's better quality. If we've done it, it's better quality, but they've picked it. If there's a, you know, a viewer picked content, then that they've picked it, but I don't know what the percentage is.
It's around about 20%. Even Barony John's, actually, it's all user-generated, yeah. All user-generated content, so none of it we've uploaded ourselves. It's a mix. It's
20% fan-picked or 20% loaded by CJZ?
20% is uploaded by CJZ. And even with CJZ assets, we've only worked on about sort of 15 to 20%. And that's not even of the highest, you know, the highest sort of potential assets.
So that
either.
Says of the content that you've got on YouTube, 80% of it is up there from fans?
Yes.
Okay.
Around about.
Interesting. Okay. A couple of things, but we'll come back here. And I'd like to hear from Tony. And with Fremantle, you've got a lot of shows around the world. How does X Factor have a channel, or does it have X Factor Australia versus X Factor UK versus X Factor everywhere else? And what's been your experience of the changes in YouTube over the last couple of years?
So answering your first question, we tend to have local channels, and we've kind of launched those in different territories. So I started off in the UK, which has been one of the territories that was most active in this space. We are actually looking at launching global channels, though, so hubs of those, because especially working on X Factor Australia this year, we really saw our global audience take off. We saw a lot of engagement from other territories as well. And one of my favourite clips actually is one of a fan who's made their top 10 favourite X Factor auditions based on the UK, the Australian and the US version as well. And that's, you know, that's a viewer who potentially doesn't live in any of those territories, but through YouTube, what they're doing and watching on a weekly basis, and they're becoming very engaged with these shows. So we launch with local channels across all of our brands. I guess the big changes for us is that we, as you can see, the platform's evolving fantastically, which is great. The analytics we get really help us in terms of refine how we package that content and what people, which parts of the episodes they really want to see. Our shows lend themselves very luckily, not just because they're big global brands that people recognise, but the way that the shows are produced. They tend to work really well in short form. Audition content, for example, on those talent shows perform really well, but obviously once you get to live shows again, you've got performance clips. But looking at analytics, we're able to really refine about whether people are interested in hearing the backstories that happened before, whether they want to hear judges' comments afterwards, and really tighten that proposition.
Okay. I think rights is one of the areas that people often want to talk about. Nick, you touched on this. When you make a show for 10 or for the ABC, you negotiate the rights with them. Do they have the rights on YouTube, or do you have the rights on YouTube, or is it territorial, or is it a case-by-case thing?
YouTube, we're trying to be a bit careful. We're trying to be a bit careful with how we deal with YouTube rights, because if the ABC puts something up on YouTube, they're probably, I assume that their internal policy is they won't put ads on it, and therefore there's no commercial benefit from it going up there. But then again, the ABC itself, we give the ABC quite a lot of rights. We've just made the show The Checkout, and I'd like to talk about that later, because that has the last 4 minutes of every episode was content that we got through YouTube, or UGC, and it was incredibly successful. They've been running, they have a lot of online rights to clip the show up into little clips. It's a consumer affairs show that we made as a joint venture with the Chaser guys. And it clips up really nicely into the individual stories. And the ABC have had it up on YouTube, so it's on YouTube as clips and as shows and stuff, and it's on their own iView site and on the ABC website. Now, because of the way the ABC promote it, it is incredibly successful online portal, and very, very successful on iView, and it's not watched that much on YouTube. So it's their number one show on iView, and it's really not making much of a blip on YouTube, which is interesting given we're using YouTube, content that's uploaded through YouTube in a thing called FYouTube, which would cause the ABC lawyers some worries, because they thought YouTube would come after them for using presumably the word tube in the name of something. But it's called FYouTube. People can upload a complaint about a company and, say FU to them, basically. But that's a four-minute segment at the end of the program, and which we turn around every week, and that's worked really, really well. And that user-generated content being made for our show and broadcast nationally has made some, made consumers more aware of their rights, and it's made some companies change their internal policies. But that's been UGC. And really good, but so as far as the original question, we try and hold on to as many rights as we can. That's becoming more and more difficult. But with YouTube, obviously we have rights outside the country, even if they have some upload rights here. So we might agree not to upload anything to YouTube, but we can't stop the 80% of people who are uploading our stuff to YouTube. Once it's up there, we control it, and that's the important thing, that we control it, because we say that's a creative right of ours to control whether we take it down or leave it up. That's our right, that's not the broadcaster right, because it's a creative decision.
See?
I think one big thing to consider is that regardless of any program you make, the community is going to create a community around your content on every single platform, and if you enable them to do that, it will enable your content to grow and be seen and engaged with. It also is about where you spend money, promoting your content. If you choose to promote it on iView as ABC does, then everyone will go there. If you choose to promote it on YouTube, then everyone will go there as well. So it's about educating your audience on where they should go. The same as with Jimmy Kimmel. He tells people to engage on YouTube and people go to YouTube. And as regards to the rights management as well, I mean, it's interesting that in this country, a lot of the rights are with the networks. And they often, you create a program and they take your content and they say, yep, cool, and we're going to take all your rights as well, and we're going to go and do all this cool stuff with your content on all these other platforms. And often they don't do it. And often they've only got rights in this country as well, and so it limits you as the producer to really leverage your content proficiently worldwide, because a lot of the content, for example, that's viewed on YouTube, only about between 10 and 20% of the content for Australian productions is viewed in this country. So the rest of it is viewed worldwide, so immediately you break down the geographical boundaries of your content and you're able to identify new markets where your format or your idea may be picked up, and you'll find a lot of other opportunities. So. Another way that sort of enables you to be able to realise the potential of your content as well, by launching it on that platform. There's a lot of interesting things you can do there.
But Nick, Steve, thinking specifically, you said there's a Hungry Beast episode that's had 27 million views. Is that monetized? Is that particular episode monetized? And if so, is it ABC or is those views outside of Australia, so they're with Cordell Jigsaw? Where does that one sit?
They are... We actually been negotiating that the rights to that channel for about 9 months and sort of recently got that back, which is cool. And they won't do anything with it. So it was just sitting there doing nothing. It wasn't content matched. There was no CMS. Nothing was being...
This is
nothing.
The ABC you're saying. They
this is the
it,
ABC. Yeah. So I received that back and I jumped into the CMS and basically set it up as it should be set up and enabled in other countries. And it is being monetized in every other country but Australia. But already the return has increased dramatically. I won't tell you how much, but it's a great sum within a very short period of time. It's just a matter of how to use the CMS and analytics.
So you're able in that case then to manage your obligations with a public broadcaster to have it unmonetized in YouTube, but to monetize it in other countries. So you can have that split between no advertising in Australia and advertising overseas.
So any program you have, you can identify, you know, which countries you are or are not monetizing your content in, or you know, you can change the relationship in every single country. Mm-hmm. You can do as much as you, I mean, there's a lot of opportunities that probably aren't being realised as well, and your back catalogue, a lot of you guys probably have a back catalogue of content that isn't being utilised proficiently. So you can go into that content and identify assets that have high virality and build a strategy around that content to enable, you know, it to be monetised. And a lot of people, I guess, are missing that opportunity.
One of the points about that, though, and this is really worth doing, on our new shows, we try to build into the budget of new shows the ability to have, a social media person on it and some management of how we deal with platforms like YouTube, and that's built into the budget of the shows. But to go back and digitise our catalogue and to be able to upload it even as a reference file so that we can do the content matching, that is a really significant investment for our company. We've got a lot of back catalogue stuff. If you go back and try and upload all your old content, it takes a long time because of the way, and hopefully this will be fixed this month, but it takes a long time just because of the way the internet tends to work, the upload speeds of the internet, and there's just so much content, and you've got to digitize it and turn it into a different kind of file, and then upload big, long, huge files up to, because we upload everything in full res to YouTube. So it's a very, very long and expensive process, and that's one of the reasons we've spent so much money in the last couple of years on it, because it's just, you know, we've got someone sitting there all the time just churning through old programs and turning them into digital files and uploading it. That's a big investment. It hopefully will pay off over time, but you know, we're a long way from breaking even on that investment, and we see it as a long-term thing, and it's very different from the stuff we're doing on a show that's on right now, you know, that's got the ability to get it all up there every week, and at the end of the show we don't have to worry about it, it's all there. You know, the stuff that Fremantle and Shine are doing is fantastic. You know, it's all up there. There are bits being created for these platforms. It's really, really great. And it's really, if you can do that at the time, that's the secret. If you're trying to reverse engineer everything, that's a lot of work, and it's really expensive, and there's nothing to charge that expense to because the show's finished.
Tony, have you at Fremantle had issues where you're claiming the rights against a broadcaster who's got it up in a channel, or how do you deal with the rights in those circumstances? Because you've been looking after that content for quite some time, but the broadcasters kind of, to me, on the rights base, sometimes they claim it, sometimes they don't, sometimes they're aware of it, sometimes they think they have rights that they don't have. So what's been your experience?
It's generally quite smooth sailing. We tend to work very quickly with the network when a new show's commissioned and discuss how that's going to work. We tend to retain all YouTube rights. And to say, I mean, a lot of our shows, YouTube isn't appropriate in terms of having an official channel just because of the way the show's made. It doesn't really lend itself to short form. But at the very least, we retain those rights. We put up reference files for anything that's pre-recorded in advance. There are occasionally exceptions where we grant a network permission to put something up within their catch-up window. For example, Wentworth, which was a new Foxtel drama, Foxtel put that episode online and allowed a maximum audience to see that, which... certainly didn't help its ratings because it had such fantastic ratings on Foxtel. So there are exceptions to that, but generally speaking, we work together. We make sure that what we're doing is also supporting their digital strategy. So just because we have official clips on the YouTube channel doesn't mean it's the detriment of an official website on 7 or 9, for example. We try and make sure there's a good call to action about what else is on that website, and we don't see them cannibalizing each other. We see traffic increasing as YouTube increases too.
You made a comment then about YouTube as short form. Do you see YouTube as a more short form channel than a long form channel?
I think at this point, yes. I mean, there's been lots of exceptions of projects like that, and Christian's mentioned in the UK, you know, it's being tested and used as a catch-up platform. The way that rights currently sit here is that we do continue to let our networks lead with long form and catch up. So what we tend to do is our policy tends to be where we can, official clips, kind of short form, so I'm talking up to 3 to 4 minutes. And then we tend to block any long-form content worldwide and keep clips up of about 7 minutes, which tends to be enough for any highlights that people want to upload, or if people want to create some really interesting mashups, that people can still do that without that time frame.
Okay, and what's one of the interesting things we talked about before was you're now making content specifically for YouTube rather than just your shows. That's right, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
There's a clip that we've got here, which is of some content. I think it's Steph in prison. Is that right?
Yeah, I think so.
Have you got that clip there? I think this is the trip. Okay. While we see whether we've got it or not. Nick, are you looking at making content specifically for YouTube rather than just taking your broadcast content and putting it on there? And I'm not really talking about the UGC that you might capture with people making that for something like Checkout, but I'm talking about you making that kind of production content for YouTube.
The answer to that is yes, we are talking about it. The answer as to whether we're actually going to do it is less definitive, because I don't see, at the moment, unless it's associated with a show where there's a separate budget sitting for it, there's no business case for that. I mean, the business case is for something that you get an enormous number of views for something on YouTube that's already been paid for or is very cheap to make, and you
but
get it
27
up there.
Million is an enormous number of views, and you've had that for one episode. So,
but that came out, that was a story out of an episode that had been funded, you know, separately from that. So if you go, okay, we're now going to... I mean, look, I'll tell you what, on the Hungry Beast example, Hungry Beast is a great online, is a great brand, and it could easily live as a channel on YouTube with new stories coming from it. So could Bondi Rescue, so could the Ronnie Johns Half Hour, but to make the content at the same quality that people are already viewing it on YouTube is expensive. It would have to be, if you're doing something where you're not sure of what your revenue stream's going to be, then it needs to be made really cheaply. And the stuff that's being made allegedly at no cost, if there are actors and writers and directors involved, that means they're not being paid. And we can't make stuff where we're not paying people. So that puts, I mean, we're not at a disadvantage, is that the reality is we don't make stuff where we're not paying people. And therefore, it's unlikely that we can do things.
And
like
you don't
that.
Feel that YouTube's proven itself as the business model for making content that goes out there first?
No, because we need to know how much revenue. So if you're going to spend $50,000 doing something, you need to know that there's $50,000 worth of revenue attached to that. So the way our business works, I mean, the people who are not doing that are the US studios and the people who invest in feature films and things. But television is a business which if you make it speculative, the margins that we make aren't high enough that we can afford to run speculative production in the hope that an audience will come to it and we'll be able to make our money back. We'll go broke if we did that.
Steve, one of the things that...
Here's your clip here, look.
Excellent. Right, let's have a little quick look at this.
So, how are you feeling, Steph?
Yeah, good. Great. Yeah, really positive.
And how are you really feeling?
Yeah, terrified.
Can you turn the audio down?
That's only natural.
Tell me about this clip. Where did this clip come from and what was it linked to?
So the woman on screen is Steph Scully, who's one of our characters in Neighbours. She came back recently for a 6-week storyline, and prior to that she'd been off air for a couple of years because the character had been in prison for, I think it was a hit and run accident. She was a really, really popular character at the time, but what we wanted to do when she came back was to try and attract fans of the show who still really knew and liked her but had stopped watching Neighbours. So this for us was a marketing exercise. She was going to be here for 6 weeks. So what we produced was a series of webisodes where each webisode was based around a counselling session. So it ran for about 2 to 3 minutes, talking through issues that she'd been having and things that she was apprehensive about returning to Ramsay Street. And every counselling session ended with a cliffhanger, which then played out in that week's storyline. So for us, it was a way of giving extra character development that we didn't have time to fit into the main episodes, which the
so you had really you had webisodes and the YouTube channel as well as Neighbours.
So these webisodes existed. They were on YouTube. They were also on our official website, but we knew YouTube was a really key point of attracting an audience who weren't already really engaged with the show.
And what have been the results of doing this experiment for you?
They've been really good. I don't want to give full credit to this, but the ratings from this point onward have been up year on year for about 10 weeks now. We had our biggest ratings last week for about 20 months. But
is that,
a lot
is that
of that
here or in the UK?
Here. Right. These haven't played out yet in the UK. Right. But this is also, and the other thing, I mean, this is the big challenge with global shows that are on tape and different, is that we had to tie this so that it could work as a countdown to her arrival on screen, whereas here in Australia, it was kind of parallel to while she was on screen.
So in some way, you're making content, but you're making content linked to another property. So I get, Nick, what you're saying is creating a brand new series on YouTube is a bit different, and you have to know what your returns are. In your case, Tony, what you're doing is taking a known property and then giving it an extension on YouTube so that it can have more life and create more audience.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm fine with the clip then, thanks. One of the things I did want to drill into, which came up before, is this idea of where fans pick your content and put it out there, and you then claim the monetizing of it, and you can track the analytics. You can't do the annotations, is that correct? You can't annotate it in the way that you might want. But one of the things that has been talked about is the idea, Nick, you said when you reach a certain volume, you get a step change in advertising. Steve, how does that step change happen? What makes that step change happen at a viewpoint? And what viewpoint is it that you can suddenly move your advertising from one level to another?
So it's really, I guess, when you form a community of individuals. So it might be a series of production companies or a series of talent. And when you have a collective number of enough content, then you can serve ads to your content. You can have people go to market and essentially sell views to your channel, to your network, to your type, whatever it is, and generate more revenue. So at the moment, in the current way, as a partner with YouTube, you do get a certain CPM, which is a cost per 1,000 views. But if you're part of a broader, like a multi-channel network, which is actually something we're creating at the moment, it'll enable you to be able to get a much higher return.
Why do you get a higher return? Why does a multi-channel network give you a higher return?
As I said, essentially because you've got, there's a few different reasons. One, within a multi-channel network, you'll generally have expertise and advice that'll enable you to be able to build your community faster, build your network faster. Someone who's already learned from their mistakes and ensure you don't need to invest as much or sink as much into experimenting with your process, but actually identify the right process for you and your organization. And then another key part is actually having someone at the back end who goes to market and sells your assets, as a media seller in the market, and therefore gets a higher return, a higher higher CPM. Instead of getting $25 CPM, you might be getting a $60, $70, or an $80 CPM. And it has a significant impact because obviously then you're getting a higher return on investment.
So effectively,
and then you're
tripling
more inclined to create content.
Tripling
for that
your
platform.
Revenue. Yeah. Okay, so that's interesting. So do you need a certain number of views before you can really start to use a multi-channel network? I mean, are the people here who have small channels that might have thousands of subscribers, are they able to take advantage of this, or do you need to have a significant number?
Yeah, if you're part of a multi-channel network, then you're able to do something like that. There aren't many in this country. There's one, but what we're actually creating at the moment is one that's specifically for producers and for talent as well, so anyone who is a creator of content. So it's hard to find the right one that understands your approach to television, understand the rights and all the other issues that are involved with television.
Nick, when you made the best of for Bondi Rescue, were those shown on television or were those YouTube only?
No, they were for television. They were for 10, and they ran over Easter on when in the non-ratings period so that the show itself could stay on air over Easter.
And the content of those was defined by the YouTube audience, the analytics that came from...
We had an idea of what we liked and then were able to cross-match that with what was working on YouTube, and you could look at the kind of... the kind of audience we know, on we could also look at Facebook and see what people were talking about on Facebook as well. But the YouTube analytics let us see what was the most popular clip, and there we go, if it's popular on YouTube, then you know, that's probably something we should be incorporating in the show.
Now, I think this is, one of the great advantages of using a digital platform that has good analytics behind it, is finding out what content people like. You can look at what your fans are loading, you can look what they're picking out there, you can look at the videos they're making for you of the favourite auditions on X Factor, and for you of what they're looking at that comes up in Facebook and YouTube. Those analytics must be telling you what your audience is up to in ways that television ratings never give you that experience. They never really tell you what bits the audience likes specifically of your shows.
Well, certainly on the uploaded stuff, if someone grabs a sketch from a sketch comedy show and puts it up, that presumably means that was
they
their
like
favourite
sketch
from the show. But I might say, it's not rocket science, because you know, people were uploading, you know, the chopper sketches from the Ronnie Johns Half Hour. We already knew that they were the best thing in the show, and they were uploading that. But there were a couple of surprises. There was a sketch called Underground, which was Jordan Raskopoulos and Felicity Ward, sort of the sort of goth people standing outside a club waiting to get into a club, just chatting about inane shit. And that was huge on YouTube, and was really, really huge in the US. It had a very, very big US audience, those clips that got uploaded. So they're uploaded by someone in Australia, but then the audience was in the US. So that was a surprise. But most of the other stuff, we sort of knew that it would have an audience. You've still got to realise that the broadcasters are, in their decision making on commissioning shows and recommissioning them for subsequent series, you know, that has to be based on their audience. They can't recommission a show because it's doing well on YouTube. They've got to commission a show because it's doing well on their network, and because, you know, an extra, you know, a million viewers on television is much more valuable to everyone than a million viewers on YouTube.
But if you're somebody who's making a show for the first, or if you're making a new show, not a recommission, but a new show, surely having, you know, a couple of hundred thousand people on YouTube who like your show and subscribe to your show and follow your show will give you some analytic information to justify walking into a broadcaster and saying, I've already got a show with an audience.
Yeah. I mean, it's a tool. It's a tool in our arsenal of why they should recommission it, or why they should commission it in the first place if we've already done some test sketches or something and put it up on YouTube. That's possible. And certainly, you know, Heath Franklin is a really big star in Australia thanks to how his stuff took off on YouTube from the Ronnie Johns Half Hour. And the fact he's incredibly talented, but he was sort of one of the top, I think the third highest grossing comedy act in Australia, live comedy act in Australia, for two or three years, while the show wasn't on air, and it was really just that was a YouTube driven, live comedy stardom that he got. It was brilliant. So he'll attest to its power.
Tony, you know that people are taking your shows and cutting them up and making their own shows out of them. Do you do that? Does Fremantle do that yourselves with your shows to make new content? In some ways, I suppose Nick's best of that he made could have been something that they chose to do and load only on YouTube. Do you ever use the YouTube analytics and what the audience is doing to make new content out of your own content?
It's kind of interesting because the analytics are fantastic. They really give you a good indication of what people like, and they definitely affect how we create content for that platform. But there's so much of it which is also kind of hard to predict as well. They're not indicative of how, to use X Factor again, you know, the most popular contestants aren't necessarily the ones that are most viewed on YouTube. And we had a really one audition of an act called D&D who weren't the strongest singers, but quite an entertaining audition. They didn't register really on the show or in media, but for some reason got a million views in the Ukraine, and we have no idea why. We're assuming the Jimmy Kimmel equivalent found it, put it on air, and brought attention to it. So that's a big reason why we try and make sure that we just have reference files going up all the time, because you can't always predict your big hit. The Susan Boyle phenomenon, which is kind of what really made Fremantle wake up to this show, and is a big reason of why Got Talent as a format is in so many countries as well, is because we were, you know, marketing that show on that platform. We knew that was going to be a big part of the episode, but no one could have preempted that sort of reaction.